Morning and welcome to worship on this beautiful Sunday morning. So glad that you could be here to worship with us today, either on site or online. There are a few announcements that I'd like to draw your attention to, but first I want to point out the cards in the pockets of the seat in front of you. Now would be a good time for you to grab that green connection card and fill that out so that we have a record of your attendance here with us today. And let us know any joys or concerns that you would like to have shared later in the service as we go to prayer together. Also, if you are new to Downey Avenue Christian Church, we want to send a very special welcome to you. And if you are worshiping with us online and this is your first time, feel free to use that chat section and let us know that you are worshiping here with us, and we will gladly send you a very special welcome on this Sunday morning. There are a few bits of announcements that I'd like to get to. Coming up next week is our graduation Sunday on June 5th. So we are going to be celebrating all those who are graduating from preschool all the way up to grad school and beyond. So if you are someone who has graduated or have a family member who has graduated, then we want to celebrate you. So let us know, either online or here in person, let us know so that we can appropriately celebrate your achievements and join in that celebration for you and with you. That, again, that's coming up next Sunday, so time is of the essence there. And then the following Sunday is our Downey 101. If you are relatively new to Downey and you have questions about who we are, what does this mission statement of ours actually mean? What do we do about that and with that? Then this Downey 101 luncheon is for you. And hey, you get a free lunch out of it, right? So if you would like to connect through the 101, there is an RSVP form that went out in our Sunday morning email this morning. If you don't receive that email, then let us know in the chat and we'll be glad to get you connected to the Downey 101 email or RSVP form. But either way, we want to have you join in that luncheon conversation with us. And then also coming up in like 2 weeks is Pride. And the Pride festivities that are happening, we are looking for folks to participate in Pride, and Toma's going to share a little bit about that later, or at the Welcome Center, right? At the Welcome Center, if you'd like to participate during fellowship time, then keep your ears open for how you can participate in the Pride festivities and represent Downey Avenue Christian Church. Summer is upon us. I picked my kids up from their last day of school last week, blaring the Ozzy Osbourne song, School's Out for Summer. They were not impressed, but, as you could clearly see from her face, not impressed. But school is out for summer. But worship and wonder is still continuing to happen on Sunday mornings. And so we are looking for a handful of folks who can help with worship and wonder a week or two during the summer and give our regular worship and wonder volunteers a bit of a break for these couple of months. So if you would like to tell stories with the kids or engage with crafts and activities during that time, then please see Pastor Adam and this gentleman here. And he will be glad to get you connected and give you everything that you need to be able to participate in that. We also are looking for folks to host fellowship time. We love our fellowship time, right? Yes, so we are looking for folks to host fellowship time. We're still looking for folks who can serve in the nursery every now and then without needing to be on a fixed schedule. So if you can participate in either of those two, then see either Pastor Adam or myself, and we will be glad to get you connected. Those are all the news bits and announcements I have for today. So now I invite you to rise as you are able. Let's join together in our mission statement that we at Downey Avenue Christian Church are called to be transformed by God's radical love to build a welcoming church, a just community, and a sustainable world. I invite you now to pass the peace with one another in the way that feels safe and comfortable to you. Thank you.
still my strength and shield. Be thou still my strength and shield. When I tread the verge of Jordan, bid my anxious fears subside. Bear me through the swelling current, land me safe on Canaan's side. Songs of praises, songs of praises, I will ever give to thee. I will ever give to thee.
I'd like to invite any children in the house to come forward for children's moment. If there's no kids in the house, you all will be the children. It's hard to be the only one. Should we? Hey, there we go. That's right. We got balcony folks. Welcome. Welcome. Well, let's see. There we go. This weekend, we celebrate Memorial Day. Does anyone know what that is? Memorial Day. No.
I think I heard it before, but I totally forgot.
Totally forgot. Thought you knew. Well, Memorial Day is a holiday to remember something really important. Memorial comes from the word memory. Do we know what having a memory is?
Yes. It's when you remember a fun time or like a really good time.
That's right. It's when you remember something, especially a fun time. And so a memorial is a place or a thing that helps people remember something. Something about their history they don't want to forget. In our Bible lesson today, the Israelites build a memorial with 12 stones taken from the bottom of a river that God helped them cross. And they built that memorial to remember how God kept them safe. There are memorials built a long time ago that are still around today. Did you know that? I'm going to show some pictures right on the screen of memorials that you might recognize. Let's look at the first picture. What's that?
The Sphinx.
The Sphinx. That's right. That's a Sphinx. And that was a kind of memorial in ancient Egypt. Yep. Let's look at the second one.
The Statue of Liberty.
The Statue of Liberty. That's a kind of memorial too. That's a memorial that was given to America as a gift from the country of France. It's so that Americans will always remember that we're a free country and that our freedoms or our liberties, liberty is just another word for freedom, are very precious. All right, there's one more. Let's look. Who recognizes that one?
It's like a big tower.
It's a big tower. Did you know that that is right here in your city of Indianapolis? That's your very special memorial. That's called the Sailors and Soldiers Memorial. And people all around the world see that and they think of the city of Indianapolis. Memorials help us remember what's important. So here's the most important question I have for you all today. If you could build a memorial to remember something really important, anything you wanted to remember, what would your memorial be for? Cat hot dog. All right, that's a great memorial. What do you all think?
Holidays,
special holiday. What's the most special holiday to you?
Easter.
That's a really good choice. What do you think? What's important to remember in your life?
Family.
A memorial to family. The church is kind of like a memorial to family. So let's be together in our church and say a prayer, okay? Dear God, thank you for helping us remember what's really important. And thank you for inspiring us to build things so that we can remember for generations to come. Bless these children and these people in this place as we move forward in your love. And as always, bless these little children. Amen. I missed that.
search my heart and know my ways. Nothing within is hidden from you. When far away my mind is known, my thoughts do not escape you. My steps are guided by your hand. You know when I rest and when I stand. Each breath I take is by your command. Your love will always hold me, guide me and enfold me. Praise your name, praise your holy name, eternal God, creator of heaven. God, the great I am, you are my Lord. When darkness comes, where can I hide? Night is light to you. Your presence shines as bright as day. Your spirit is around me. If I should ride the wings of dawn, or go to the depths of the sea, and if I rise to the highest heaven, then your love will hold me, guide me and uphold me. Praise your name, praise your holy name, eternal God, creator of heaven and earth. God, the great I am, you are my Lord. Praise your name, praise your holy name, you are my God.
This is nice. Good morning. This morning, this is not going to be so much a prayer before I read the scripture. It's just going to be a little something else. And it's Memorial Weekend, as we all know. And we have a challenge. The challenge is to make your life our life, and the things we do contribute to the spiritual purpose of this church, to God, to our community. Amen. Scripture reading, Joshua 4, 1 through 7. When the entire nation had finished crossing over the Jordan, the Lord said to Joshua, "Select 12 men from the people, one from each tribe, and command them, take 12 stones from here out of the middle of the Jordan from the place where the priest's feet stood. Carry them over to with you and lay them down in a place where you camp tonight. Then Joshua summoned the 12 men whom he had appointed from the Israelites from each tribe. Joshua said to them, pass on before the ark of the Lord our God into the middle of the Jordan, and each of you take a stone on his shoulders according to the number of tribes of Israelites, so that this may be a sign among you. When your children ask in time to come, what do these stones mean? Then you shall tell them that the waters of the Jordan were cut off in front of the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. When it was crossed over the Jordan, the waters of the Jordan were cut off. So these stones shall be the Israelites' memorial forever. May the Spirit of the Lord guide you with the understanding of the Scripture. Amen.
I've been told that it is, in fact, not Ozzy Osbourne who sang School's Out for Summer. It is Alice Cooper. I apologize to any, what is it? Is that death metal? Is that what that is? Rock and roll. Well, we could talk about that. Let's see. But I apologize to any Alice Cooper fans out there who may have been offended by my oversight. Dave says he's been listening to that song on the last day of school since 1975, so I will not make a comment about the year that I was born, and not being around then, but that's okay. Let's go to God in prayer together, shall we? Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on all of us. Open our ears and our hearts and our minds to the revelation of your good news today and every day. Amen. There are a few events that when you hear of them, you know instantaneously that they came from the Old Testament. A snake that talks humans into eating forbidden fruit. A man who generations later we would call a hero, but who is prepared to sacrifice his own son because he hears the voice of God. A woman who turns the wrong way and is instantaneously made into a pillar of salt. And on we could go with these bizarre accounts that could only come from the Old Testament. In today's Old Testament reading, we learn of another similar type of tale, the parting of the waters that flow in a mighty river. Now, most of us know about the parting of the Red Sea, right? We know about about Moses leading the Israelite people out of the land of Egypt, out of slavery, away from Pharaoh, and God parts the Red Sea and they escape to liberation. They escape to wandering in the desert for 40 years. It's so well known, they even do sketches on Saturday Night Live about it. It's become a part of pop culture. But did you know that it happened twice in the Old Testament? Did you know that there is another story where God parts the waters for the Israelite people? In this account that Jack read for us, he read for us the end of that story. So let me back up just a little bit and give us a little bit of context as to what is happening in this story. When we pick up with Joshua chapter 1, the beginning of that text in the Old Testament, we learn that Moses has died. Moses did not see the promised land. He was not able to lead the people there, and so Moses died, and in his place steps Joshua. He is now the leader of the Israelite people, taking them home, so to speak, to Canaan, to the promised land. They were on the cusp of getting into the place that they had claimed was meant for them after decades in the desert. Now, on a side note, I don't want to ignore the problematic nature of the language of promised land that's reserved for only a few. This is the language that was used to perpetuate things like manifest destiny here in this country, which led to the slaughter of indigenous populations at the hands of American colonizers. But that's a story for another day. Who knows, maybe there'll be a whole sermon series on manifest destiny. Wouldn't that be fun? Anyway, let's put aside the gross misuse of scriptural text, if we can, and let's set the scene for this amazing story. The people who've wandered in the desert for 40 years are finally on the verge of home. Generations grew up in this place where they had no home that would be a foreign word to them. But first, they've got to get across that mighty Jordan River that flows, the last barrier between them and the rest of their lives. And Joshua, their leader, he is undaunted despite this barrier in front of them. And so he follows God's commands, and he instructs the people to prepare for this journey they are about to take. And it all hovers around, centers on the Ark of the Covenant, this most holy relic for the people of Israel. It was to be carried only by the Levite priests, who could only touch the poles of the Ark, not the Ark itself, or they would surely die. And Joshua stood before the assembly of the hundreds of thousands of Israelites as they prepared to cross the river, and he gave them instructions on how they might do this. He says, pack up your tents, and then as the Ark of the Covenant passes between the camp, follow in line behind it, but not too close. You must stay 2,000 cubits away, which is about 1,000 yards. So the Ark of the Covenant is so powerful, you have to stay 10 football fields length away from it, or you might surely die. So the people fall in line, one family after another, behind the Ark of the Covenant. And as the priests who are holding and carrying that ark step their feet into the water of the Jordan River, the scriptures tell us that God piles the water up in a heap, creating a dry surface for them to walk across. And Joshua tells the people, as soon as the priests make it to the center of the river, they will stop, and they will hold the ark there. And that is when you walk across to the other side. But first, there must be 12 men, one from each of the 12 tribes represented in this clan of the Israelites, who will go and carry a stone and place it on their shoulder and carry it out of the waters and place it as a memorial on the east side, on the other side of the river. And then Joshua himself, as the people cross, comes into the middle of the river where the priests stand with the Ark of the Covenant. And he pulls out 12 stones from the river bed and places them in the middle of the river. The scripture tells us they are still there to this day. I don't know if anyone has done any diving to go find that. But Joshua built the memorial in the midst of the riverbed. And then as soon as he was finished, he led the priests with the Ark of the Covenant out of the riverbed. And once all the people and the priests and the Ark of the Covenant and Joshua had made it across the other side, the scripture tells us that the water of the Jordan River flowed so mightily that it overflowed the banks of the river. But the people were safe on the other side, one step closer to home. And there, once they were on the other side, they took those 12 stones and they placed them in a place called Gilgal, which really is just a Hebrew word meaning circle of standing stones. And they are meant to serve as a memorial to what God did for the people on that day, so that when their children or their children's children ask what those stones represent, that can tell that story of what God had done to save them. Joshua chapter 4, the chapter that Jack just read for us, the first seven verses, the last verse in that chapter says, "So that all the peoples of the earth may know that the hand of the Lord is mighty, and so that you may fear the Lord your God forever." 12 stones, so that all would know the great wonders of their God. And as I read this story this week, I wondered if the descendants of those who crossed that river ever went to that spot, kind of like we might go to a cemetery or a place of memorial with the people that we love. I wondered if folks ever gathered there at those 12 stones to remember. I wondered if a grandparent ever held the hand of their grandchild years after the event had taken place, when they were just a child themselves, and told them the story of what had happened with that on that day with the same awe and wonder that they had as a child. I wondered if there was a mother who ever lost her child, who knelt there at that site hoping for a small measure of what that God on that day had been able to provide. That God who could stop the waters of a rushing river. A God who could bring people out of slavery. A God who could bring forth water from the rock in the midst of the desert. What good do those stones do if that God is no longer that God? On this Memorial Day weekend, as Adam said earlier, we are called to remember. And maybe as we make our way to the family barbecues and pool parties, and I hope you're doing that. Are you doing something fun to celebrate? God knows we need it for our own well-being, right? But in addition to that, I'm hopeful that we can also place our hearts and minds at the banks of the Jordan River and see those 12 stones there, reminding us of what God has done. It's true, friends, that we live in a broken world where children are killed indiscriminately in what should be safe places, where grocery shoppers are gunned down simply because of the color of their skin, where women's bodies are pawns in political games, and transgender children are criminalized for living into the fullness of their created beauty. It feels like we are living in what the TV show Stranger Things calls the upside down. A place where monsters reign and where all hope feels lost. Last week, I talked about the light that shines in the darkness and the darkness that cannot overcome it, but I am having difficulty seeing the light. It feels as though the light is about to be overcome. Maybe it feels like the waters of the Jordan River are slowly overtaking us. Have you struggled this week to find words to adequately express what you're thinking and feeling? Words of rage, bitterness, deep sorrow and heartache. That is exactly what most of us are feeling. That is real and that is true. And as a result, we are desperate for a reminder. We are desperate for some sort of memorial that shows us that God is still able to pull back the waters that threaten to drown us. And if we look closely enough, friends, there are stones. There are stones in this life that remind us that God is still that God. Fired up about the most recent mass shooting, a massive crowd of people stood outside a convention center in Houston, Texas, that was sparsely populated for the NRA convention, and they shouted, "No more. Enough is enough." and one stone was placed on the riverbank. Women's healthcare facilities have reported record donations to support women in need in their own healthcare decisions as a result of the Supreme Court leak. And one stone is placed on the riverbank. The Social Security Administration just announced that they are simplifying the process to have gender markers changed on Social Security cards by removing the need of proof from a doctor, so that people can now have job applications that match their Social Security card, and they're now able to apply for Social Security benefits in the gender that they identify as. One stone placed on the riverbank. Monarch butterflies have wintered in Mexico for generations, but they were decimated a few years ago because of climate change. Well, did you know that scientists last winter saw a complete return to the monarch butterflies? And their populations have swollen to astronomical numbers that they've never before seen. One stone on the riverbank. Now, if you're thinking that whenever something troublesome happens, we can just look to something good and see if they balance each other out, that's not what I'm suggesting. I'm not suggesting that the world works that way, that we can just wash away what has happened, but I am suggesting that these stones call us to remember the whole story. The Israelites surely remember that one day, but they cannot forget what happened for the 40 years that they wandered in the desert just because of that one day. Think of the many times that they had come to the banks of that Jordan River hoping to cross when nothing happened. When all they could do was stand there and look at where they wanted to go and who they wanted to be, but the waters flowed and they could not make their way. We have to hold those two things together. The depths of our despair, the heartache and brokenness that we experience in this world, and those moments of God's penetrating love that break through into that and show us that that God, who can pile water up in heaps, is still that God. What are the stones in your own life that point to that God's presence with you? I bet if we look, we can find at least one or two. A stone that we can look to and say, remember that time when I was desperate and alone and hopeless, and God was there, parting the waters that threatened to drown me. That God is still that God. And when we stand on the banks of the Jordan River, whatever that represents for us, look to the other side and see the stones that have been piled up there for you as a reminder. On this Memorial Day weekend, what we memorialize shapes who we become. How we remember the times of our lives points to the way we live our lives. Let us remember that God with the 12 stones of our own lives on the banks of the Gilgal, the banks of the Jordan River. Because friends, in the midst of that darkness, that God is still that God. Amen. If you're joining us via YouTube, we apologize for losing the YouTube feed. We're still recording, so hopefully you'll be able to come back and watch the service later, but we apologize for the technical difficulties there. We come now to this time when we sing our hymn of response, and if you have completed those green connection cards, this would be the time that we collect those, so be sure to share any joys or concerns that you would like to be lifted up in our time together, and David will come around and collect those. Now I invite you to rise as you are able. Let's sing together our hymn of response.
Share with you the words from Maya Angelou. I think a hero is any person really intent on making this world a better place for all people. This weekend commemorates Memorial Day, traditionally a weekend of celebrations with family, grilling out, trips to vacation homes to lakes and parks, a weekend of carefree living. But Memorial Day and the weekend we associate with it was created to honor American heroes, the fallen, those lost in the line of service, those who held strong dreams, convictions, and passions, and who died for them. A more somber celebration than it has become for our society today, a day for memories of those lost. I'd like us, as a church family today, to focus on Memorial Day as a day of memories and remembrance for all the heroes described by Maya Angelou, those whose lives have been lost, be they from the past century, the past year, or the past 2 weeks. The heroes of our world, our communities, and our lives, all of whom who had passions and dreams to make the world a better place, and who held strong to them to the end. Remember and cherish those heroes from across the country and from the Downey congregation who gave themselves in the line of duty to the horrific wars of our past, sacrificing of themselves and for a dream for a better world. Remember and cherish the 10 heroic souls tragically lost in New York, happy, caring, everyday people who loved their families, their churches, and had hearts of service for their community. Remember and cherish the 21 heroes lost in Texas this week, the teachers with a passion to educate and form bright futures of youngsters in their community, the 19 beautiful, innocent children filled with passion about things like sports, cheerleading, dancing, school achievements, who had dreams of birthday parties, of trips to Disney World, of being TikTok stars, of plans to go to college to study law, possibilities and dreams yet to be realized. Remember and cherish those from our Downey family who we've lost this past year, each of whom were devoted to their families and had passions and dreams that were lived out daily during their time with us. Dorothea Chase, Judy Genrich, Ruth Heimer, each who were passionate members of the May Ward Group here at Downey. Hannah Crutchfield, with her love of fairy gardens and passion for spending time with friends at her preschool Downey Co-op and through the various family ministries at Downey. Joe Lehman, who shared his passion for music here at church and in the community. Joella Hyatt and Jean Ballard, both strong in their faith, shared with the Downey congregation. And William McDermott, a man of faith and leadership in Downey, serving as a beloved pastor. Yes, as Maya Angelou so perfectly described them, heroes are persons intent on making this world a better place for all people. When we remember the heroes of Downey, we can also remember and cherish them by supporting the various ministries of this church in which they participated and held dear through our generosity of gifts, be they of money or time, enabling us to support our church mission and make this world a better place for all, like placing our own stones on the river. You may make your contributions by placing them in the baskets as the deacons pass through the aisles, or by making an online gift through the church website, or by mailing them to the church office. No matter how you choose to give, may it be given freely, generously from your heart, a heart of a hero.
Dear Savior, grant that our offering may show we remember what many seem to forget, that real happiness does not come by acquiring or possessing, but giving and serving. Amen.
We've come to the time in the service where we lift the joys and concerns that are on your hearts and your minds to prayer to God together, that we might join in unity in lifting such prayers. I'd like to remind you that on the green cards, our joy and concern is a spot for your joys and concerns. So if you're in the building, that is the best way to submit prayer requests. They can always be sent throughout the week to communications@downeyavenue.com. This morning, prayers requested from Martha Fowler for her aunt, Martha Lawrence, who fell and broke her hip. From Amy and Darren Huber, first, thanks for preparing me to minister to our world, and thanks for celebrating my ordination. Amen. And pray for our 17-year-old niece, Jessie, who woke today very ill. We remember Jessie. A prayer that we remember all of those who gave the ultimate sacrifice in defense of our country. Amen. And prayers for all our veterans and the struggles that they face. We also lift up all the prayers shared but asked not to be spoken aloud. Let us join together now in prayer. I'm sorry, two more. Prayers for Jennifer and her new work situation and the fluctuation of hours available, and so prayers that those will become more steady and life-giving. And then an update on Jenny Beth Baker. This past week she was in Michigan having a visit, and she fell and fractured her pelvis as well. It is minor. She was able to drive home. She is back at Robin Run, doesn't have to go to any kind of special room. She can be in her space, and she's well taken care of. Her son Steve was with him on the trip and was able to take care of her. So that is the update and prayers for Jenny Beth. Let us be in prayer. O good and merciful God, we come to you in prayer because we know that you hear us. We know that our prayerful intentions move something in your world of love, center some spirit of goodness, some force of healing and wholeness and salvation on those that we lift up. That it is not simply thoughts and prayers, but our prayers are holy and reverent, and they belong to you. When we align our spirit with our mind and our heart, when we listen for your still small voice in the world, when we find a stone to put on our pile of rocks, something in the world is moved, and you have heard the names of those that we need you to move around, that your spirit will surround and strengthen and heal and uplift. For that is the power of your goodness and your love. To be the force in the world that we don't understand, but that brings blessing. That all we can do is be grateful and hopeful in what God will do next. Help us sustain such a hope, O Lord. Help us remember what is important and what matters. Help us to have the courage to tell those stories first. The human condition is hard, but it's meaningful and miraculous if we will simply notice you. And so we close in prayer this day, praying together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And let us not fall into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
And gather here, we are called to remember a night when Jesus gave himself for many. But we would not have this table, and this would not be cause for celebration if there wasn't a stone involved. For 3 days later, the stone was moved and death was beaten. Life always has the final say because of love. And so it's important for us to remember in balance the sacrifice that Jesus has made and know that the power of love that brought Jesus out, that rolled that stone away, is the power of love that still lives in all of us. And when we eat this bread and drink this cup, we are taking in that love. And it can redefine us, it can shape us, it can overwhelm us, it can redeem us. But let us take it in today as one more stone on the banks of the river of our life. Let us pray.
God of love, Spirit of compassion, bless us and these elements. May this meal be food and drink for our journey, renewing, sustaining, and making us whole. Send us from here to reveal your love in the world. Inspire in us the resolve and the courage, the compassion and the passion to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with you. Amen.
Amen. On the night that Jesus was to be betrayed, before his death, he shared a meal, the Passover meal, with his friends. And at that meal, he took the bread that they shared, he blessed it and broke it, and he handed it to those seated around the table with him and said, "Take and eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you." When supper had ended, he took the cup and he blessed it. And he passed it around the table, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sin. As often as you drink from this cup and eat this bread, remember me." Careful. Do you like them? They're pretty good, aren't they? Let us drink from the cup of God's unceasing love together. I want to give a special thanks to those who ventured out from the west side of town, the Williams, the Hoovers. Man, we're so grateful that you're here and fought through that traffic to be here. Your dedication is unmatched. Toma Baston is hosting fellowship time in the parlor, so be sure to stick around and enjoy a special Memorial Day fellowship time. Again, if you would like to host fellowship time in the future, we would love to take you up on that, so see Adam or myself. And if you are interested in picking up a week or two during the summer to work with the kiddos during Worship and Wonder, see Adam and we'll be glad to get you connected. Youth group at 11:30 in the parlor making signs for Pride. And if you want to help make signs that say God loves all people regardless of who you are, then you're welcome to join and make signs as well. And we'll just have a sign, good old-fashioned sign-making party. Those still exist. Let's go in prayer together as we close our time together. God, remind us that there are stones all around pointing to your miraculous, awe-inspiring love. Open our eyes to see your presence walking beside us every moment of every day. Help us to remember who you are. Amen. Go now in peace.